So, hi, I'm Suraj Narvade. I work at Red Hat, and I'm gonna talk about the project Catch. This is about me. I contribute to projects like Compose, libcompose, Catch, and I work around Kubernetes OpenShift. So, to define a simple application around Kubernetes, you need this much big of YAML, which has like deployment, services, ingress controllers, and lot more than that. So it's very tedious to write this much big of YAML, and developer hates to write YAMLs, or they don't like to maintain this YAML, right? So, and what was the main problem with it? So it's not a user-friendly. It has very complicated YAML structure, as you can see. It has like lots of metadata into it. And the thing is, those YAMLs were designed in a way that API should use it, not the user, unfortunately. So they are machine-friendly but not human-friendly. And here's the equivalent case definition for these big YAML. Maybe these are like 50, 60 lines of YAML, but a cache you have to write almost 7 to 8 lines, which does the same thing. What's the cache? So cache is simple, concise, declarative Kubernetes application. So 1 year back, we started with Compose project. So it was started by Skipbox, and then we joined them. So, but during the development of Compose, we have seen some gaps that not each and every key can be mapped to the Kubernetes manifest from the Docker Compose, because Docker Compose was made for the local development or maybe a Docker swarm. So we learned some lesson from the Docker Compose, and we started with the Catch project. As you can see, the Catch definition, it has very simplified form, right? Like we added some shortcuts like ingress endpoint. You just need to add ingress endpoint, and it will automatically generate the ingresses. And it's not limited to that only, because you can extend the whole power of Kubernetes into it, because we are directly taking the structs from the Kubernetes, and we are adding some feature on top of it. So Catch, compared to Kubernetes manifest, it has a very less complicated and more straightforward YAML structure, smarter defaults and best practices. So we followed best practices for the Kubernetes as well. We added some of the shortcuts like port mappings, health checks. We have done the parameterization for the environment variables as well, and we have also added auto completion in VS Code and Eclipse J. So features, we now completely support OpenShift with the Catch, like S2I builds, build config, deployment config, route, image streams. So we added shortcuts for ingress, routes, port mapping, health checks, and all. On the build side, we support OpenShift S2I build from the OpenShift cluster. And if you want to bootstrap a new Catch file, it's very easy to do that. You just have to do Catch init, and you are ready to play with Kubernetes. What's our roadmap? So we are trying to add triggers for OpenShift deployment configs in a more easier way. Currently, you can define triggers, but in a similar way how OpenShift does, but we are trying to simplify that. Then easy, we want to enhance the file bootstrapping method using Catch init and the UX. So I'll quickly show you about demo as well. So I'll simply show you like how you can easily bootstrap a Catch file. You can just do Catch init help, and you can see the all parameters needed, like controller, image, name, and the output filing and the ports. So if you do catch init, let's say hyphen n posicia hyphen I CentOS and hyphen p 80. So it says file cache.yaml created. If you see cache.yaml file, the we bootstrap one ukage file which you can easily deploy, and you get an easy quick start for the Kubernetes. If you check other cache file, so it's a simple httpd cache file. It has a name, deployments, it has image, center slash httpd and service. So in Kubernetes, let's see. So this is the corresponding Kubernetes artifact, and this is the cache file. So if you see here in the service, you have to define port and target port. Like it's a two different thing, right? So to avoid the complexity, we have added port mapping key, and where you can add the list of the all port mappings over there. But that doesn't mean you cannot define in that way. You can also define in that way because we are directly taking the structs from the Kubernetes. And you have, let's say you want to deploy this thing, just have to do cache apply or maybe cache create on this file, and this file are get created or reconfigured on the my mini-shift. So here's my mini-shift dashboard, and here's my httpd container is running. If I check the route, it's running. So this is how we can define Kubernetes artifact in a easier way. So I have one more thing to show here. Yeah, the cache. So recently I have created a demo for the Spring Boot application using cache. So as you can see, I have a cache.yaml here which has all the configurations for the cache, then the source code for my Spring Boot application. So here's my cache file. So if you see the cache file, it has a blank image field because I already have a source code, and in the runtime it will generate an image name for the image stream and it will fill it. Then I have an environment variable app jar because my Spring Boot application have two jar files in the target. Then I have defined a trigger here. This is exact similar trigger which you can define in OpenShift artifact. We are trying to simplify this. Then routes and services. Now what I will do is cache build hyphen hyphen s2i. That means I am telling the cluster from cache that we have to use s2i build strategy. Then image name I have to give Spring Boot, and then builder image. So I am using this OpenJDK image from the Red Hat registry because it supports incremental build as well, because in the first time it will fetch all Maven dependencies from the any Maven repository, but if your builder image doesn't have incremental build, it will fetch Maven dependency at all time. So to reduce that, to use save artifacts, we are using this OpenJDK image. So if you see the logs, it says image stream and build config created, and then it will pull all the artifacts, all the Maven dependencies. It takes around 5 to 6 minutes of time at first build time because it fetches all the dependencies. Now, when build is completed using S2I, it will send that image to the internal registry of the OpenShift. Now push is successful, and if we check the image stream with the name Spring Boot is created. And now we are applying the similar cache file we did earlier. And if you see on this OpenShift dashboard, the application is created with the name Spring Boot, and if you check the route URL, you see the basic Spring Boot HTTP booster. Now, how local development will work in the OpenShift native development? So now again, I'll make some changes in the code in the index.html page. I'm just modifying the header, and I'm again doing the cache build here. So it says image stream configured and build config also reconfigured. So it again takes the new source code. Now if you see here, it's pulling the image from the internal registry. That means it's using the incremental build strategy, and it's using the all saved artifacts. And on top of that, it's adding new code. Since we have added a trigger for the deployment config, so that like after image in image stream gets updated, deployment will also reconfigure. You see here, the Spring Boot has hash 2, that means it's a second deployment, and deployment was like auto triggered. And if you check the output, HTTP booster by cache was created. So in this way, we can have a OpenShift native development. And to know more about cache, this is our website, cacheproject.org, and so experimental purpose, there are like multiple projects in Kubernetes ecosystem who are trying to solve the similar kind of problems like application definition. So for experimental purpose, we have done some integrations with the Helm plugin. Helm is a kind of templating of the Kubernetes application definition. Then we also did some experimental integration with Draft plugin, which is by Microsoft. And to have a good LSP integration, language server integration, that also we have done with the VS Code and Eclipse Shape. And if you want to talk to us, we are on Cache Project Slack. We have our repo under Cache Project, and this is our website. And before that, recently we also added a cool feature of the validation. So we also added schema based validation for the cache. So I'll give you a quick demo of that. So let's say if there is some extra key is present in your cache file, and you are trying to deploy the cache file, if you are trying to generate Kubernetes YAML with it, it will not work, and it will say the cache file is not valid. There's an additional property batman which is not allowed. So in this way, you can also validate your cache file as well. So the same same schema we are also using in VS Code Eclipse. So in that way, the user will have a it will be very useful to write cache file using those kind of editors. So that's about my project. And if you want to contact me, these are my contact details. And any questions about the project? So based on cache, I created my weekend project. I wanted to demonstrate that. So 2 years back, the Dice guys, they have wrote a blog, awesome blog about Children's Guide to Kubernetes. And I got some inspiration from that blog. It's in very simple way they explain Kubernetes to a children. And so what I think the my project, if that blog is Children's Guide to Kubernetes, so this idea is about children's way of deploying to Kubernetes. Maybe it will definitely solve a day zero problem. So at day zero, every developer is like kid or children. So it definitely solves their problem. So this is my OpenShift running locally, and to deploy a simple guestbook application, we need this much big of YAML. But instead of that, what we can do is, I have created my own blocks using Scratch. So Scratch uses a library known as Blockly, which was written by Google. So I use the library Blockly to create my own blocks. So those blocks are based on the cache only, which I demonstrated. So you can just drag and drop the blocks, you can put the image name, you just put the port mappings you wanted, and let's say you want one more service, you just copy paste and you get one more service, again fill in the blanks and one more service. In this way, like you can have a visual representation of your application definition of your Kubernetes OpenShift application. And just once you are done, just click on deploy. And it says your application is deployed successfully, and you can check your output as well. So this is a simple guestbook application. So currently this my project is based on cache, which I demonstrated earlier, and it's in a very hackish way, but yeah, it works. Thank you.